Hi everybody, hope you're well. Today I'll read from a book titled Hollywood Arensberg, Avant-Garde Collecting in Mid-Century LA by Mark Nelson, William Sherman and Ellen Hubler, published by the Getty Research Institute. In 1949, at the end of a whistle-stop tour of America's finest art collections, the New York Times critic Eileen Lusheim found herself in front of a large, rather nondescript and very un-Hollywood house in Hollywood, California. When the owners Louise and Walter Arensberg opened the door, Lusheim encountered one of the most extraordinary installations of art ever assembled in a private home. Having grown accustomed to the expensive impressionists in elaborate Louis XV frames, she was amazed by both the radical art on the walls and its idiosyncratic methods of display. Lusheim described the scene to Times readers in vivid detail. Paintings were jammed and crowded on every available space, from floor to ceiling. They filled the porch, trembled on the backs of doors, and lined the bathrooms. The house held nearly 40 artworks by Marcel Duchamp, paintings by Pablo Picasso, Georges Braque, Paul Klee, Henri Matisse, Joan Miró, and other modern masters hung edge to edge in every room. The dense array extended beyond the walls to the floors and other surfaces. Interspersed with nearly 20 sculptures by Constantin Brancusi, there were a mass of other objects, ex votos, bits of Americana, Indian sculpture, and African and pre-Columbian carvings. Significant specimens of American and European furniture rested on a patchwork of Persian rugs, piled in some places two or three deep. "How outstanding," she reported. "These gentle, gracious, past middle-aged people who are my hosts are as at home with this art, as unself-conscious and unpretentious about it as once a grandmother was about Victorian chromos and doodabs." Lusheim's astonishment was understandable. Los Angeles was surprisingly slow to embrace modernism in its many forms. New artistic initiatives often met with hostility, and the city did not establish a permanent museum dedicated to modern art until 1961, nearly a decade after the Arensberg's death. Yet, for more than 20 years, from the late 1920s to the early 1950s, Louise and Walter Arensberg generously opened their Hollywood home to a constant stream of visitors. Most of them were friends from their wide circle of artists, authors, and actors, but many were members of the general public hoping for a glimpse of the couple's legendary collection. One of their earliest and most persistent guests was Caris Wilson, an aspiring writer who later became the photographer Edward Weston's collaborator and wife. After taking a job only a few streets away, Wilson found it a daily struggle to refrain from ringing the doorbell. Walter welcomed her often enough to extend her education with longer tours of the collection, during which he welcomed her comments on the placement of particular pictures and dazzled her with explanations of the complex symbolism he found in them. These puzzles grew out of Walter's intellectual preoccupations as a practicing poet and amateur scholar of Renaissance culture, and they point to another much less known part of the Arensberg's collection. Throughout the house, there were thousands of books stacked on tables and crammed over shelves on topics ranging from mythology to cryptography and featuring the world's largest private library of works of the Renaissance-era scientist and statesman Sir Francis Bacon. Long celebrated for inventing the scientific method, reforming the British legal system, developing the essay form in English, and producing one of history's most ingenious cipher systems, Bacon, rather than Shakespeare, was considered by many to be the preeminent writer of the English Renaissance. Indeed, many people were persuaded that Bacon was the true author of Shakespeare's plays. Among them, Walter, who spent many years searching for the evidence that would support this claim, poring over books in his office and explaining his theory to anyone who expressed an interest in the subject. The Arensbergs' artistic tastes had been transformed by their encounter with the works in the Armory Show. The exhibition took the American public by storm and hit the Arensbergs, as Walter's Harvard classmate William Ivins later recalled, between wind and water. The exhibition affected the couple so profoundly that by early 1914 they had abandoned their settled life at the historic house known as Shady Hill in Cambridge, Massachusetts, for a bohemian existence in an apartment on Manhattan's Upper West Side. Regretting their tentative purchases at the show itself, they soon began an assiduous search to assemble all those works they had missed the first time around. Within a year, they had established themselves as preeminent patrons of the show's most infamous artist, Marcel Duchamp. They put him up in their own home when he moved to New York in the summer of 1915, and then arranged a studio for him in their building, paying his rent in exchange for ownership of the large glass. But after a decade indulging their every whim, they were on the brink of insolvency. Thinking they had no other choice, Louise and Walter consigned all but their most beloved artworks to Charles Schiller to sell through the Gallery of Marius Desailles. Their prize pieces, however, found purchasers only in John Quinn, who bought very little, and in Catherine Dreyer, to whom they sold the large glass. Though the Arensbergs were expecting a windfall, one was not forthcoming. They instead put their art in storage and moved to California. In September 1927, the Arensbergs finally settled into 7065 Hillside Avenue, a large house nestled in the hills just north of Hollywood Boulevard. Set back from the street behind a generous front yard with gating and foliage along the sidewalk and a two-car garage, the house was almost completely hidden from view, and the privacy it afforded surely appealed to the couple. Though it was a conservative and relatively typical example of the Mediterranean Revival-style architecture then at the height of its popularity in Southern California, the home's spacious interiors must have seemed to the Arensbergs a fine fit for their maturing relationship, its high walls the perfect blank slate on which to reimagine their art collection. By 1936, the walls of the Arensbergs' Hollywood house were far from empty. They now held so much of Duchamp's work that as the artist embarked on the project Boîte en Valise, he could reacquaint himself with many of the originals in the new house of his old friends. Immediately upon walking through the front door, visitors to the Arensbergs' house in Hollywood were put in a position to consider what it might mean to place the work of one artist next to that of another, or to consider how a sculpture by Brancusi might be interpreted differently when accompanied by an Aztec gold ring or a dinosaur print. Likewise, readers of this book are taken on a tour through a series of spaces in which we find traces of the intellectual and biographical associations that brought the collection to life for the couple who created it. These photographs testify to the elaborate arrangements that once brought paintings, sculptures, and drawings into close contact with leather-bound volumes, exotic carpets, historical furniture, and indigenous artifacts. After 1929, as many Americans were suffering through the Great Depression, the Arensbergs found their fortunes revived. The couple began purchasing art again after nearly a decade-long hiatus, buying so much so quickly that they ran out of place to put it. Thus, in 1933, they initiated a round of architectural modifications, commissioning Richard Neutra and his assistant Gregory Ain to design and oversee the construction of a spacious new gallery room at the rear of the house. Along with the building of the sunroom, as it came to be called, came the attendant need to fill it, for the Arensbergs seemingly could not leave any surface bare. Though they quickly covered its walls, tables, and shelves with new possessions, they continued to lament the loss of the most significant piece in their New York collection, Duchamp's large glass. This was a collection that cut across periods, cultures, and media, establishing a dialogue between art and books, the European and the American, the ancient and the avant-garde. The Arensbergs had wanted to keep their collections together and hoped to find an arrangement that would allow them to remain in Los Angeles. Ultimately, though, the art and art-related archives went to the Philadelphia Museum of Art, while the Baconian books, Walter's working papers, and many of the couple's personal documents stayed behind in Southern California, finding their way in 1996 to the Huntington Library. Ask for the book at your local bookstore. Thank you very much for watching this video, and see you in the next one. Bye.